A pleasant good morning to all. Good morning. How's everyone feeling today? All right. Thank you for the tour over there. How's everyone feeling this morning? Amen. God is good. It's a beautiful day. He kept us, amen, alive to see this beautiful day. And if you believe that, can we please just clap our hands unto the Lord this morning? Can we just clap our hands? Because he is a wonderful Savior, mighty God, everlasting Father. Amen. Just want to say welcome to all present here today for day two of the Integrity Commission third inter-high school debate competition 2017. And for those who missed yesterday, I'm telling you, you missed an awesome debate. Can we put our hands together for our students who participated in the debate yesterday? I see present here government officials in the form of the UNDERSEC, directors, past principal, teachers, students. Good morning. Please just let me single out just one person. I am not the one who would bring the official welcome, but I just want to single out one person here present because she was the one who helped mold my life and just did a lot for me. And I believe she believed in me because the amount of beating that I took from her, I am the man I am today. Can you please put our hands together for Mrs. Lillian Mizek present here? Yes. She was the past principal of this school, and trust me, you do not know who you have in your presence, so you better embrace that. One more time, Ms. Mizek, I love you. Okay, the Bible says, and 1 Peter 2, having our conversation among the Gentiles, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers, that they may by your good works, when they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation. Amen. And with this scripture, Peter is saying it's okay to observe others around you, those who you come in contact with every day. It's okay to watch their behavior. And I must endorse what was said yesterday by the director of Integrity Commission when he used the illustration of a student. If you are a student at this school or wherever you may be, and if you find a $5 or maybe a $50, would you actually return that $5 or $50, not knowing that it is not yours? And like many others, I sat there yesterday and I smiled with a few that the artist that was there, and I was like, you know what? Yeah. What if I really have found a $5 or $50 on my way walking out of these grounds? To me, personally, I probably would have said, oh my God, this is a blessing from the Lord. Lord, I thank you that you started my day right. A $50? Oh my. But honestly, it is not mine. Would you really, really return that money? And I sat upon those, and I was thinking about it at work, and I was like, you know what? It's so true. I'm thinking it would be a blessing for me, but it's probably some teacher or student money. And I'm feeling happy to spend it. So I'm going to ask you one more time. If you find money in this ground, would you return the money? Thank you for the two honest persons who said yes. And for the rest, please do return it. Because today, like Peter is saying here in this book, people are watching more of what you do than what you say. Okay? They see if our behavior matches our belief, if our walk matches our talk, if our character matches our confession. If what we claim to believe on Sunday is put to practice on Monday. In other words, students, they're watching if we have integrity. Integrity say we got to obey authority. Integrity say we might not like the law, but I have to obey the law. Integrity say I might not like the person in the office, but I have to honor the position. Integrity says I might not like the direction the nation or the country is going, but I have to pray for God's intervention. Last, integrity says, I will obey God first, even if it means I suffer the penalty for doing the right thing. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise this morning. We thank you for this beautiful day, a day that you have made. Help us and teach us to rejoice and to be glad in it. We thank you for everyone present here today, those who will be taking part in day two of this debate. Mainly we pray for the strength, wisdom, and guidance of the students who will be speaking today. Let them be put aside and that you speak through them. We thank you for our moderator. We thank you for the staff and team of the Integrity Commission, God, that you would continue to guide and direct their path for the job that they're doing within this community. God, all those who are listening by means of radio, we ask that you would bless, strengthen, heal, and deliver. We ask that you would just let your perfect will be done this very day. Let us not fail to give you thanks because of your goodness. It's not of our strength, but only in your strength. We thank you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, can we all stand? This is the part where I allow you to participate. We will all stand and we will sing the one verse of the national anthem and the national song. Can we all raise the national anthem after two? Are we ready? One, two.
Long live.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Thank you, Mr. Dickinson. Good morning, everyone. Good morning and welcome to the last day of the Integrity Commission's third inter-high school debate competition. Again, my name is Charlene DeBell and I will be your chairperson for today's event. Today's moot is, be it resolved, the presence of an integrity commission will discourage corrupt behaviors. Before we begin, it will be remiss of me not to extend a warm welcome to some persons in our audience, namely our commissioners, the director of the integrity commission, the deputy director of the integrity commission, and all other staff of the integrity commission, the representative from the Ministry of Education, To our honorable judges, Ms. Shetelia Hall, Dr. Benjamin, Honorable Lillian Mizik, and Dr. Therese Maitland, a pleasant morning. To our two teams participating today, Raymond Gardner High and Clement Howell High School, good morning and give it your all today. Last but not least, to all the attendees and persons listening via radio, welcome and thank you for joining us today for day two of our competition. Now, without further ado, I'd like to call on the Deputy Permanent Secretary of the Ministry of Education to bring brief remarks.
Good morning. What I'd like to say this morning, first of all, I think Honorable Lillian Mizik deserves to give Nick those kind of disciplinary actions that he called for way back in the 1900s. I guess it really made him a better man today. So thank you again, Honorable Mizik. Head Judge Honorable Lillian Mizik, Reverend Julia Williams, and the Reverend Kenneth Mark Kendall, our two commissioners, our esteemed judges, and our students from the Raymond Gardner and also from Clement Howell High School. Good morning to you all. First of all, I'll say that the minister sends her apology. That's the Minister Honorable Josephine Connolly. She is present at the Spelling Bee in Providence Alice today. So she sends her apologies and all the best wishes to you guys that one of you must be successful in this debate. Also, I bring apologies for the Permanent Secretary for the Ministry of Education, that's Charlene Jones. She is present also at our evaluation this morning that she was not able to make this here this morning, but she'll come later on down if the evaluation finishes in time. It is an honor to be invited to address the most impressive audience at the Integrity Commission Inter-High School Debate 2017. As Deputy Permanent Secretary, I deemed it an honor to be given this opportunity to address the most important audience on what is arguably a most interesting and important high school debate. I believe that in the principles of integrity, like the vast majority of our citizens, such principles underpins our educational curriculum. They guide and strengthens the citizens to do the right thing because it is the right thing to do. Collectively, as a nation, if we ensure we embrace and live with integrity, we will shape not only our lives, but the value of our lives and enrich the quality of our lives in the Turks and Caicos Islands. The Ministry of Education welcomes the presence of our young citizens who have taken up the challenge to lift the morals and ethical standards in our community. Becoming involved in the Integrity Commission debate, it is one of the most impressive things that a student can do. I know at the end of this debate, we have Raymond Gardner on our side, on my left side, and Clement Howell on my right side. I wish both teams, all eight of you, all the best luck. Come out armed with all the ammunition that you have planned. I know you have planned for several days and weeks coming up to this debate. And I wish both of you luck. And one of you will have the bragging rights for the rest of the year, and come December 2017, on the 9th of December, you will receive your award. And you will receive that award during the celebration of the National Corruption Day. That is my understanding. In addition to this, I'd like to thank the director because he's moving further to actually start a an integrity club in the schools. And I want to tell you firsthand that we welcome that, because if we can start out with training our young ones to have integrity from the very beginning, it will follow through, and at the end we'll have a nation full of persons with integrity and a well-respected nation around the world. So once again, I will congratulate you all for making it thus far. And the teams that got eliminated yesterday, that's Wesleyan Methodist and Marjorie Bison High School. Maybe you're just shy of your points, but I'd like to also congratulate you for being present and taking part in this debate. Give them a round of applause, please. There must be a winner. So next year, I know you guys will come out armed and ready. And it just shows you that you have to just put in a little bit more. That's all it is. But this mood today, I mean, I'm going to stay here until this is, I can't wait for this debate to start. Be it resolved that the presence of the Integrity Commission will discourage corrupt behavior. I'm waiting for these points to go on. So with that said, I wish you guys all the best. And I know that some across the day that, I mean, my minister will be listening via her radio, or she'll make a call in to check on to see what is going on. And since this is live via radio, we can all hear what is going on here. Thank you guys, and I wish you all the best, and have a wonderful day.
Thank you, Mr. Cox, for those remarks. We'll now call on Ms. McCartney, the Public Education Officer of the Integrity Commission, to coordinate the introduction of the judges, the two teams, and bring brief guidelines.
Distinguished guests, all of our students, ladies and gentlemen, a pleasant good morning. I would like to welcome you to our final day of the TCI Integrity Commission Inter-High School Debate 2017 on behalf of the commissioners and staff of the Integrity Commission. Yesterday, we did have an awesome day, and I would like for you to please give all of our teams, Clement Howell High School, Raymond Gardner High School, Wesley Methodist School, and Marjorie Bason High School, a round of applause. They all did exemplary. However, our winners who will be debating today are Raymond Gardner High School, please stand. And Clement Howell High School. And indeed, we are all excited to hear, be it resolved, the presence of an Integrity Commission will discourage corrupt behaviors. I will now pause to allow our panel of judges to introduce themselves. We have representatives from the Ministry of Health, from our community, from the Director of Public Prosecution's Office, and also from our public-private hospital, InterHealth Hospitals. We'll start with introductions from my left.
I'm also a former head girl of this fine school, H.J. Robinson, and it is indeed a pleasure to be here. Thank you.
And good morning again. I am Lillian Mizik, and I'm here with you today as I was yesterday.
Good Morning. I am Shatalia Hall, Public Prosecutor from the Director of Public Prosecution's Office, and I look forward to hearing you guys debate once again.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Dr. Antrieve Benjamin. I'm a general practitioner at the Coburnton Medical Center, and I must say that I'm very happy to be here with you all today.
Thank you. Thank you, honorable judges, and we know that they will judge with integrity, with objectivity and transparency. I will now allow our students to introduce themselves so you'll know who they are. We'll start with Raymond Gardner High School.
My name is Jasco Corville. I am a 3A student at the Raymond Gardner High School.
My name is Joshua St. Michael McGoo. I'm in Form 4A from the Raymond Gardner High School.
Good morning. My name is Leah Bima Dorsten. I'm also a student of Form 4A of the Raymond Gardner High School.
Good morning. My name is Brianne Gardner, a 4A student of the Raymond Gardner High School.
Clement Howell High School will now introduce themselves.
Good morning. My name is Nicole Bennett, and I'm the deputy head coach at Clement Howell High School.
Good morning. My name is
Good morning, my name is Janika Noel, and I'm a fifth form student of the Clement Howell High School.
Good morning, my name is Kenley Smith. I'm in the class 3CL1 at Clement Howell High School.
I'll now pause and ask us all to stand, please. We're going to have a moment of silence for Ms. Takitra Elliott. She was a part of the 2015 debating team for Marjorie Baston High School, and that was the winning team for that year. Just a minute of silence, please. Thank you. May she rise in glory when Christ returns. Before I go through the summary of the guidelines, I'm just going to ask a representative from each team to come and pick whether they will be proposing or opposing.
Clement Howell proposing.
Raymond Gardner opposing.
Okay, we heard. As they are seated, Clement Howell High School will be proposing, and Raymond Gardner High School will be opposing. Now, the few guidelines. Debaters may use personally prepared research briefs and published materials. Some references have and was provided on the Integrity Commission website page. The proposition team makes a case for the motion. The opposition team opposes the case made by the proposition team using direct and indirect rejections. Speakers may make their presentations in the following order. Proposal 1, 10 minutes. Opposer 1, 10 minutes. Proposer 2, 7 minutes. Opposer 2, 7 minutes. Proposer 3, 5 minutes. Opposer 3, 5 minutes. Opposer rebuttal, 5 minutes. And proposal rebuttal, 5 minutes. Debaters had from April last year in order to prepare for the event. They're being graded on content, delivery, organization, points offered, points taken, teamwork, timekeeping, and overall impression. They will now have half an hour to prepare themselves. all the best to both teams.
Ladies and gentlemen, esteemed guests, most accurate timekeeper, worthy opponents, chairperson, unbiased judges, I greet you all. The mood states, be it resolved, the presence of an integrity commission will discourage corrupt behaviors. My colleagues and I firmly agree with this argument. As the first speaker of the proposition, it is my duty to restate the mood. The key terms in this mood are presence, integrity, commission, discourage, corrupt, and behaviors. The Oxford Online Dictionary defines presence as the state of existing and discourage as to persuade against an action. The International Monetary Fund defines corrupt as the abuse of power for the benefit of one's party, class, tribe, friends, family, and self. The Oxford Dictionary defines behavior as the way in which one acts or conducts oneself. Integrity as the quality of being honest and having strong moral principles, and commission as a group of people entrusted by the government or other official body with authority to do something. Therefore, the mood can be restated as, be it resolved, the existence of a group of people entrusted by the government to be honest and morally upright will persuade others from willingly abusing their power for the benefit of one's immediate and distant connections. I, the first speaker of my team, will enlighten any darkness on the difference between discourage and stop, on transparency, and on the various aspects and the utmost importance of awareness. My second speaker will shed some light on fear and bribery. And my third speaker will land the finishing blow by highlighting the level of wages in the public sector and the penalty system. As mentioned, to discourage is to persuade someone else from something. Stop, however, may be defined as bringing to an end. A crucial first step in persuading against the willingness of others to participate in dishonest actions is to ensure awareness. We cannot depend on everyone's ideas of morals. As to some, morals are a mere matter of perspective. What is seen as wrong by one individual is entirely acceptable by another. Based on the law, corrupt behaviors include abuse of office, exploiting conflicts of interest or personal interest, and the misuse of public resources. The existence of the Integrity Commission would certainly deter corrupt behaviors as it stands in the way of nepotism, favoritism, and bullying. Now let's be honest. How likely is it that a runner will see a tree and run into it? Programs similar to those run by the Hong Kong ICAC Community Relations Department stand as the leaves of these trees, rattling in an attempt to educate us of its presence. These leaves range from a YouTube channel to a television drama aimed towards aiding the public to identify and act on corrupt conduct when they encounter it. According to www.integritycommission.tc, the Turks and Caicos Integrity Commission, our personal tree, plans to stand in the way of corrupt behaviors by receiving and investigating complaints regarding any alleged breaches of the Code of Conduct or Integrity Ordinance or Political Activities Ordinances. To receive, examine, and retain all declarations filed under the Integrity Commission Ordinance is stated as another responsibility of our firmly rooted tree. The www.integritycommission.org.tt, the official site of the Trinidad and Tobago Integrity Commission, sums up its functions into being education and enlistment of public support, prevention, investigation, and enforcement. If these trees are to persuade against dishonest behaviors, they cannot, I repeat, cannot afford to be affected by seasons. These trees need to be in full bloom at all times. Without leaves, our trees serve no purpose. One of the most important byproducts of awareness is the matter of transparency of laws. Knowing exactly what is against the law alerts officials of their limits. For example, an act of corruption listed by the TCI Integrity Commission is if a public officer improperly uses for his benefit or that of a third party any classified or confidential information that he has obtained in his duties as a public official.
Judging by the fact that corruption is a breach of the law, this statement makes it quite clear that utilizing documents obtained at work as a public officer for personal gain is illegal. Due to the fact that this specific act of corruption is punishable by a minimum of 6 months imprisonment or is based on the discretion of the magistrate, I am certain that it persuades against the willingness to act in such a way. I believe no one actually means it when they say, I will do this because I can, no matter the consequences. In Trinidad and Tobago, the vision of transforming the country into a corruption-free country is a mammoth one. It requires, first of all, a vivid imagination, courage, and great faith in the future. It also requires unwavering commitment to make a difference in development and growth of the country. Whether this vision is fully realizable, there was no option but to try to make it so. Great credit must be given to the early commissioners who in some instances undertook direct investigations themselves. An integrity commission does not, of itself, create men and women of honor. It can only follow the rules set out in its mandate in order to try to ensure that those who come under its purview comply with the requirements of the act which guides its operations. The commission stands as the guardian of the social contract between persons in public life in all our institutions. Behavior in the public sector has a strong influence on what transpires in the private sector. The life of those engaged in corrupt behaviors can be likened to the children's story called The Emperor's New Clothes, translated by Hans Christian Andersen in 1837. This classical story refers to an emperor who was fooled into wearing invisible garments by two swindlers who pretended to be weavers. Eventually, it was brought to his attention that he was naked, always wearing his birthday suit. The emperor's decadence eventually led him to rely on the reports of others who were deceptive and left him with his assets exposed to the public. This story is similar to those who fall into the temptation of indulging in corrupt practices. These persons, and perhaps their family members, may be subjected to public ridicule and ostracism. A sound character of integrity would be the former clothing that a person may trade away for one that they think may help them to get ahead in life. The deception, like the emperor who thought that he had impressed the crowd, is that this newly adopted character may make an individual feel like he is untouchable until the reality exposes the ugliness of the situation. The only person in that narrative setting, an example to be followed, was the child, the little whistleblower. As Thich Hanh said, awareness is like the sun. When it shines on things, they are transformed. Honorable judges, ladies and gentlemen, I thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ben. Moving right along, we will now hear from the first speaker of the opposing team, Raymond Gardner, Ms. Jessica Corville.
Madam Chairperson, esteemed judges, accurate timekeeper, my opponents, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Be it resolved, the presence of an integrity commission will discourage corrupt behaviors. Today, I rise to oppose the move. But before I address the issue at hand, I will first define the operative terms in the move. Oxford defines present as the state or fact of existing, occurring, or being present in a place or thing. Defines commission as a group of people who seek to promote honesty and moral courage, particularly among persons in public life. It defines courage as the act of preventing or trying to prevent something by showing disapproval or creating difficulties. defines corrupt as being evil or morally depraved, and defines behavior as the way in which one acts or conducts oneself. Murders, mismanagement of funds, bribery, abuse, scandals, etc., are all forms of corruption which continuously deteriorate the image of many countries in the world today, and in most cases is the main reason for a country's downfall. Are there not laws? Are there not penalties that the individuals who commit these crimes have to face? I'm pretty sure that countries that suffer the tremendous blows as a result of these actions have at least one or numerous bases of integrity commissions installed around their country in various settlements. So tell me why, my opponents, is there really a reason to be here right now contradicting my factual points of disagreement on this move? Let's go to the Bible for a quick second here. God in all his power and might created the Ten Commandments as the order by which we his children should live by and adhere to. But we see where men do not necessarily obey these commandments despite the fact that they will lose their opportunity in entering the promised land. So if God the Almighty, who created men in his own perfect image and has the power to eliminate anyone at any given time, is being daily ignored and disobeyed by men, are you really trying to tell me that the presence of a body of average individuals who possess mere human qualities and hold limited powers have the capacity to rule the mind of a nation? No, this is not so. It takes more than just the body of officials to reduce the levels of corrupt behaviors in crime in our country and many others. Does my presence here today, strongly opposing the moon, which we are all aware is a blunt misunderstanding, stop you from proposing the moon? I will quote the words of Barack Obama. Change will not come if we wait for some other person or some other time. We are the ones we've been waiting for. We are the change that we seek. This statement of plain truth can be used to raise objectives on the reason why many issues we face in our society today are leading to the destruction of our world. Yes, indeed, if human beings refuse to change their ridiculous ways and lifestyles, there is absolutely no way we can ever reduce the high rate of corrupt behaviors in our country. We are the change that we seek. How can we expect peace and cooperation when there is a battle among ourselves? Come on, let's have a reality check here. As students coming from various institutions, I believe that there are rules or policies that are instilled in our various institutions. Sanctions are imposed when we fail to abide by these rules that we are in fact aware of. But does that stop us from constantly breaking those rules in some way or another? My proposers, let's be honest with ourselves for a second. We as students have indeed broken school rules on many occasions, haven't we? Can you stand here in good conscience and tell me that you have never broken a school rule? Does the presence of the rule itself prevent you from breaking them? Or is it your value system that allows you to make that choice? Madam Chaperone, honorable judges, I do not wish to attack or discriminate the constitution of any country, but I must say, how long has an integrity commission existed in many of our neighboring countries in the world? For example, the JDF, Jamaica Defense Force, JC, Jamaica Customs, JCF, Jamaica Constabulary Force. Is it that these bodies are not put in place, or is it that the people responsible fail to uphold these standards that reflect integrity? Despite all these attempts to combat crime, corrupted individuals make it difficult for lawmakers to reap rewards, as we continue to hear cases of bribery, immorality, fraud, misconduct in the public sector, money laundering, and the list goes on. Corrupt behaviors can only be discouraged in a society made up of individuals who possess positive morals and humane values such as respect, dignity, and nevertheless, all aspects of integrity. Who holds the keys to these values and attitudes? If blame must be laid, then surely we must consider other factors such as the breakdown in core family values. How can we expect an integrity commission to influence individuals whose characters have been grossly smeared? It is like expecting a child who has been diagnosed with dyslexia to have the ability to perfectly read or write. My opponents, an integrity commission has no influence on an individual who has no regard for honesty, justice, and truth. These values are inculcated at a tender age and follow an individual throughout his adult life. A good example of foregoing points would be of an ex-con who might have been locked up for drug trafficking. You would really think that after 10 years in a cell, that this person, knowing the ropes, would have changed perspective to life. But instead, this individual's come out of jail and goes right back to the streets. Am I to believe that the fear of an integrity commission will keep individuals in check? On what grounds must I expect this to be true? Are we to believe that an integrity commission has the potential to exert a stronger influence on individuals over their own consciences? What about their value system, about ideas, about right or wrong? Who determines that when faced with a choice? Is it the presence of a commission or the desire to act in a way to please one's desires and conscience? Madam Chaperone, honorable judges, my opponents, time will not permit me to elaborate, but my fellow teammates will surely help to release you out of the bondage that your mind is in. If Satan made attempts to tempt Jesus, the Son of God, the presence of an integrity commission will discourage corrupt behaviors. My opponents, come again. I rest my case.
Judges. You just heard from the first speakers of the opposing and proposing teams. Now moving on to the second speakers of the proposing team, Ms. Deborah Delny.
Honorable judges, please allow me to accept the already established protocol. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. As second speaker, it is my job to continue the good work my first speaker has begun. The presence of the Integrity Commission will discourage corrupt behavior. The causes and effects of corruption and how to combat corruption are issues that are increasingly on the national and international agendas of politicians and other policy makers, such as the Integrity Commission. The presence of the Integrity Commission helps to educate the public about doing the right thing all the time. One crucial thing is the Integrity Commission can help is to lessen the issues of bribery. Bribery can take on many forms. For example, a motorist might bribe a police officer not to issue a ticket for speeding. A citizen seeking paperwork such as birth certificates, passports, or utility line connections might bribe a functionary for foster service. Bribery may also take the form of a secret commission, a profit made by an agent in the course of his employment without the knowledge of his principal. It has become so common that many euphemisms were created for this, such as commissions, sweetener, kickback, etc. Bribers and recipients of bribery are likewise numerous, although bribers have one common denominator, and that is the financial ability to bribe. With the undeniable presence of the Integrity Commission, it can be said that it will deter persons from engaging in such devious offenses. Honorable judges, the mere presence of a stern governing body can persuade others to think twice about an action that can cause their ability to be a trusted member of our society and, at worst, their livelihood. Further, it is far from obvious that the way forward at this point is simply to add few additional offenses to the initial list consisting of the single offense of bribery. Candidates for being added to the list of offenses would include police fabricating evidence, cheating in sports by using drugs, fraudulent use of travel funds by politicians, and so on. However, there is bound to be disagreement in relation to any such list. For example, law enforcement practitioners often distinguish between fraud on one hand and corruption on the other. Most important, any such list needs to be justified by alternatives to some principle or principles. Simply speaking, if you cannot see any true or real good coming from an action and the offenses are dire, would you still do it? One might say, hey, you know, I'll still give it a chance. Ultimately, naming a set of offenses that might be regarded as instances of corruption does not prevent the need for a theoretical or quasi-theoretical account of the concepts of corruption. Ladies and gentlemen, the presence of the Integrity Commission will discourage bribery among persons in the public sector and politicians mainly, because persons in these key positions have a reputation to uphold. People do not want their good names to be tarnished, so once they feel the presence of the Integrity Commission, they will walk chalk line. Another major way in which the presence of the Integrity Commission will discourage corrupt behavior is through fear. According to TCIAffairs.net, on the 10th of October 2013, an immigration officer was arrested and charged with several counts of corruption-related offenses. The TCI Affairs was informed that the investigation was carried out by the Integrity Commission into allegations of bribery and abuse of office by the immigration officer. Reports like this place fear into people for them to not want to be involved in corruption. They know that the Integrity Commission is there to ensure that they're doing what they're supposed to be. Ladies and gentlemen, fear is considered as one of the most powerful emotions. It has arguably the most effect on human actions. Fear is the reason why a dog runs when you pick up a stone. Fear is the reason why many people avoid heights. Fear is the reason why a murderer does not kill in front of the police. Fear, ladies and gentlemen, is the reason why my sisters and I pretend to be asleep when our parents enter the room after our bedtimes. Am I the only one here seeing a pattern? Fear affects behavior. Standing as a force to be reckoned with, the Integrity Commission drives fear into the corrupt. However, this fear must be able to protect anyone who comes forward with relevant information to the Integrity Commission. They shouldn't feel as if they will not be ostracized by society for turning in their friends. They shouldn't feel as if they shouldn't bother doing the right thing because of perceived repercussions. I am sure one of the grief of the Integrity Commission is persons compromising their future out of fear. And the truth of the matter is, most of the world is out of our control. Much to my disappointment, I cannot control the world, elections, the weather, nor my neighbor's psycho dog. And truthfully, it is very frightening. When I don't turn my face away, I can see an unfolding future that I cannot control. But I can control my integrity, and other persons can too. Having the Integrity Commission here to guide us will make our future a little more brighter. I rest my case.
Thank you, Ms. Delaney. We will now hear from the opposing team, Raymond Gardner, second speaker, Joshua Meghu.
Protocol having already been established, I will further expose the futility in the belief that corrupt behavior can be stemmed by the presence of an integrity commission. If there is one thing that masterminds of criminal acts know how to accomplish, it is how to beat the system. With declining moral values among our people, not to mention the hunger for money and power, lawlessness has become the order of the day. World Bank Institute Governance Director David Kaufman participated in a live online discussion on April 13, 2016, and reported that bribery, for example, has become a trillion-dollar asset. Corruption has been shown to hold back developing countries, keeping the poorest people in poverty, and creating a major tax on enterprise growth. My teammates and I are very skeptical that an integrity commission will discourage corruption, because if one takes a look around him, he'll recognize that corruption permeates because people at the very top are managers and overseers of corruption. Why do drug dealers go by undetected? It is because the chief of police and other top notches are working on their behalf to keep the heat away from their unscrupulous acts. Shakespeare in the drama Julius Caesar alluded to how a snake may be harmless. He said that when it is in the egg, the snake is of no danger to man, but when allowed to hatch, therein lies the threat to humanity. Likewise, would an integrity commission be harmful when power is placed on persons? I hasten to remind you of instances when those people in power have been harmful with the abuse of their power. In 1994, according to globalsecurity.org, Operation Uphold Democracy was placed into Haiti by the United States of America. It was established to intervene and topple corruption in the island. From this project, the National Police Force was established. Ironically, however, through the 1990s until the present, many law enforcement agents have been engaged in excessive theft, drug trafficking, kidnapping rings, and politically motivated killings. Is there any wonder that political, governmental, and corporate corruption are at an all-time high? Members of the United States Congress do all that they can to avoid paying taxes, and yet these are the same people who want to raise the taxes. The Bible demonstrates God's rebuke of corruption and of his punishment to its offenders. Yet, corruption has never been slowed down once. Genesis 6 verse 5 states, "The Lord saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intention of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually." Note the word continually. Ladies and gentlemen, for it demonstrates that corruption will never be discouraged, and people, irrespective of any force, organization, or body put in place, it demonstrates that corruption will never be discouraged among a people, irrespective of any force, organization, or body put into place in order to curtail or eradicate corruption. It is a disturbing reality that we must contend with. Ladies and gentlemen, in this every man for himself society that we live in, how can an integrity commission succeed at discouraging corrupt behaviors? What real or imagined power does an integrity commission have to discourage corrupt behaviors? If the tactic of an integrity commission is to instill fear into the minds of potential offenders to make them reconsider acting irrationally, then I suppose that Adam and Eve would not have eaten the forbidden fruit when God warned them that in the day that they eat it, they would surely die. Another example is seen through Mahatma Gandhi, who attempted to warn Hitler via letter. Ladies and gentlemen, did you know that Mahatma Gandhi wrote Hitler begging him to reconsider going to war? But guess what? Hitler never even reconsidered his choice. Hitler went on to start World War II and made the world go into turmoil. By analogy, ladies and gentlemen, anyone who wants to do corrupt acts will not be deterred by the consequences, nor by the presence of an integrity commission. Instead, ending corruption is hinged on one's personal decision to choose right over wrong. Alas, honorable judges, and all of you who are present at this forum, man, by his very nature, is prone to being corrupt. Friedrich Nietzsche states that whoever fights against monsters should see to it that in the process, he himself does not become a monster. And if you gaze long enough into an abyss, the abyss will look right back at you. Ask yourselves, therefore, how can we trust an integrity commission will discourage corrupt behaviors when power and greed can make those persons products of the very demons of corruption? I rest my case.
Thank you, Mr. Magu. Before continuing, I just want to acknowledge the presence of the Honorable Derek Taylor in our audience. Thank you for joining us today. Well, you just heard from the second speakers of the proposing and opposing teams, respectively. We will now hear from the third speaker of the proposing team, Clement Howell High School, Janika Noel.
Protocol already being established. Be it resolved, the presence of the Integrity Commission will discourage corrupt behavior. Ladies and gentlemen, most people in the Turks and Caicos Islands should be aware of the presence of the Integrity Commission, especially since the suspension of the internal government in the year 2009. Due to the powers of the Integrity Commission rules and guidelines, it is harder for one to engage in corrupt activities without the chance of detection. Fraudulent activities in all sectors of the public sector have been the hardest hit since the inception of the Integrity Commission. Persons no longer have to concern themselves simply with the laws set down within their various departments, but have the added stress of having to stand before the Public Service Supervisory Board. The mere thought of such a body causes persons to second guess any thought of corruption. Fraud, according to fraud.org, is the wrongful or criminal deception intended to result in financial or personal gain. Fraud is a form of corruption that has cost government millions of dollars each year. When persons set out to deceive the government, they are actually harming themselves because the monies used to replace the fraud could have been used in other critical areas of society. Therefore, It is critical that the operations and presence of the Integrity Commission exist to discourage such corrupt practice and to help us help ourselves. Where there is a law, a regulation, there is always a human mastermind trying to get around it. Can you imagine if there were no laws, no watchdog, no anti-corruption committees, honorable judges? Can you even begin to imagine the hellish existence of lawlessness that would prevail? But thank God, we do not live in that world. And as long as the mere presence of the Integrity Commission exists, there is no need to fear, for one by one, the seeds of corruption and unethical practices will continue to decline. However, it is necessary to comply with the rules of the traffic department that generates thousands of dollars that go into the government's purse yearly. It is also an area hard hit by individuals who seek to outsmart government policies and also generate kickback monies on the side. Tom knows that the license on his motor vehicle is due. Tom knows that to pass the inspection to renew his license, he needs to change the ball tires on his car first. But instead of complying with the rules and guidelines, Tom decides to not complete the inspection nor attempt to license the car. Tom is fine for a few days until he turns the corner and is pulled over by authorities and his financial payment is doubled due to his neglect and attempt to deceive the government. The lesson here, honorable judges, is that a system of moral ethics and anti-corruption practices is in place and it is there to uphold the laws of the country. The presence of the Integrity Commission will discourage corrupt behavior. Persons will test the system, but systems such as the Integrity Commission that was designed to combat criminal mind will prevail. Of the areas in which the Integrity Commission will discourage corrupt behavior is inspection and licensing. Let's all be honest, there has been an improvement in this department. Driving a vehicle requires a level of knowledge, experience, skills, and physical abilities. In order to obtain a driver's license, an applicant must pass both skills and knowledge testing geared to these higher standards. Similarly, before getting a vehicle license, your vehicle must pass a certified examination. Most vehicles must also get an emissions inspection at the time of the safety inspection. Within the Department of Border and Coastal Protection, the government has in recent years erected a radar system designed to combat illegal activity on the ocean from reaching TI soil and protecting livelihood of all who live within the boundaries of these islands. The presence of the Integrity Commission has made sure that there are no shortcuts taken and persons in the community and within the department adhere to the rules. Ladies and gentlemen, we rest our case.
Thank you, Ms. Noel. We will now hear from the third speaker of the opposing team, Raymond Gardner High School, Ms. Leah Bima Dorstein.
Protocol having already been established, good morning once again. I hope that by now, the audience sees the fallacy underlying the proposition's defense of the moot and the arguments that my teammates have illustrated the fact that crimes are committed just as easily as their cover-ups take place. You have been cautioned to be wary of an integrity commission that by the very name should be an unshakable reputation for upholding honesty. However, please bear in mind that these highly intelligent and well-schooled persons who form such a commission are no less human, just as you are and I am. The second speaker of my team emphasizes the fact that man, by his very nature, is corrupt. Hence, I urge you to understand just how likely it is for those in power or higher authority to tamper with the integrity of a country rather than to uphold and defend it. Theodore Roosevelt says, "A man who has never gone to school may steal a freight car, but if he has a university education, he may steal the whole railroad." While an integrity commission should be synonymous with honesty, it cannot guarantee honesty even among its members. It is on this basis that we, the opposition, do not have the confidence of the proposition who believes that the presence of an integrity commission will discourage acts of corruption. Ladies and gentlemen, will is a strong word. In using the word will, it is stating that there is a guarantee that a positive outcome is bound to happen. I ask you, since when was anything guaranteed in this precarious world? Thomas Jefferson, who addressed the state of Virginia in voicing his concern, wrote, "Whereas it appeareth that however certain forms of government are better calculated than others to protect individuals in the free exercise of the natural rights and are at the same time themselves better guarded against degeneracy, yet experience has shown that even under the best forms, those entrusted with power have in time and by slow operations perverted it into tyranny." As our second speaker mentioned, the world has boiled down to a mentality of me, myself, and I. The selfishness of men is evidenced in his self-serving agendas to power and glory. My teammates have made reference to the Bible and to God, But I must emphasize that if people are not afraid of the one who washed away everyone but eight when he instructed Noah to build an ark, the one who with a snap of a finger can make the entire universe just a forgotten memory, then ladies and gentlemen, on what basis must I accept that people will listen to their own kind? Furthermore, Mark 13 verse 20 states that if the Lord had not cut short the days, no human being would be saved. Meaning, the more we live on this earth, the more corrupted we become. It is written in the Bible that corruption will progress without any hindrance. What more proof do you need? There is no doubt in my mind that my opponent has been journeying from the well without realizing the holes in their bucket. The arguments are presented as sand in the hand when the fingers are wide open and unable to keep the substance it struggles to grasp. That the presence of an integrity commission will discourage corrupt behaviors is remotely achievable next to nil. May I suggest to you that it can? It may, it should, but can we truly agree that it will? Lest we forget, power attracts the corruptible. I rest my case.
Thank you, Ms. Dorstein. If you were with us yesterday for the morning session, Ms. Dorstein, she was the best speaker. And for the afternoon session, Ms. Noel was the best speaker. So it's interesting to see both of them go head to head today. At this time, we will allow both teams 1 minute to deliberate and prepare their thoughts for the rebuttal.
Protocol having already been established, a blessing good morning to one and all. The first speaker compares an integrity commission as being a tree which has to be in full bloom. Question: on what basis can we agree that the integrity commission will always be in full bloom? What happens when the integrity commission takes a blow and the leaves start to wither? I'm assuming that you're saying that when the leaves start to wither, the country behavior will also wither. You also stated that the presence of the Integrity Commission stands in the way of favoritism and bullying. Mr. First Speaker, not everyone will report every case of integrity of corruption in the business. Who knows? Those who are corrupt in the business may be given slices of their case to others in the business so as to keep the business behind their lips. Come on, we all know that us humans are vulnerable to temptations that we face. The sly ones know the ropes, and the recipients are vulnerable to the reward. Ms. Second Speaker, you stated that the Integrity Commission helps to educate public about doing the right things in any situation. While your statement is true, the Integrity Commission can only do so much as give information and hope for the best. Awareness about a situation won't stop individuals from continuously making wrong decisions and be corrupt. If someone doesn't want to do something, my opponent, I can guarantee you that they won't do it. Second Speaker of Opposition, you also stated that the business wouldn't want to tarnish their name by going against the Integrity Commission. Once again, with bribes being so common, anyone in that same business may be bribed into keeping their lips sealed about any corruption that may happen, making the Integrity Commission oblivious to any corruption that may exist. The leader of that business would, of course, wouldn't want to look bad. So he would shelter his little ones under his wings, making it so that the corruption which may exist without disclosure. How can you fix something that you don't know anything about? Second Speaker, you also stated that instilling fear in people forces them to obey, listen, and run. However, my dear opponent, fear is also the reason why people go against the instruction and fight. You should know that no one wants to allow others to feel as they have gotten the better of them. Lastly, the third speaker started out by saying that people should know that, sorry,
Lastly, the third speaker started out by saying that people should know about those who... Sorry, again. Lastly, the third speaker started out by saying that people should know, but what about those who don't know? Are you leaving them out? Therefore, Madam Chaperone, judges, my opponents, it is quite evident that the Integrity Commission is just not enough to control us humans. We are the change that we have been waiting for, says Obama. Please snap out of the trance which our proposers have left you in. We want change. We are that change. I rest my case.
Thank you, Ms. Gardner. We will now hear from the rebutter of the proposing team, Mr. Nikoi Bent.
Honorable judges, ladies and gentlemen, Mrs. Chairperson, I return to the podium to finish what I started. While in the capacity of first speaker, I highlighted regulations and authorization. My second speaker spoke about bribery and fear. And my third speaker on levels of wages and the penalty system. The opposition's first speaker mentioned the Ten Commandments and how they are often disobeyed. As previously mentioned, the word discourage is a key term in the mood. Are you trying to say that the Ten Commandments do not in any way discourage us from committing sins? She went on to ask if school rules would stop students from misbehaving. Again, I must say, this is not the motion we are here to discuss. School rules, similarly to the Integrity Commission, discourage as in to persuade against an action, corrupt behaviors. My worthy opponent proceeded to point out that the Integrity Commission has no control over the mind. Ladies and gentlemen, honorable judges, is it not safe to say the officers of the Integrity Commission are our fellow humans? Wait, she did, ladies and gentlemen, utter the words, they are just humans. Hence, they possess no supernatural powers, but are you undermining their lawful prowess? The second speaker asked, what power does the Integrity Commission have to discourage corrupt behavior? Were you not listening, my opponents, when my second speaker spoke of the power and of the Integrity Commission and how they used it to arrest and charge the immigration officer in October of 2013? Moving along, honorable judges, the opposition's third speaker categorized the Integrity Commission once again as humans. Honorable judges, let's look at celebrities. Are they not humans? Don't they influence behavior? She went on to speak of a verse of the Bible, but made no reference. How must we take your word for it? As previously mentioned in my first speaker's speech, there is a difference between discourage and stop. My teammates and I strongly believe that the presence of the Integrity Commission will discourage corrupt behaviors. Ladies and gentlemen, honorable judges, having carried out the protocol, the proposition rests.
Thank you, Mr. Bent. Well, debaters, before you begin, I told you to bring your best today, and you did just that. Let's give our debaters a round of applause. Judges, we all knew that day two was going to be way more difficult than day one. At this time, we will allow the judges 30 minutes to deliberate and tally their scores. Earlier today, you heard two teams, the proposing team, the Clement Howell High School, and the opposing team, the Raymond Gardner High School, debate the last moot for today, which was, be it resolved, the presence of an integrity commission will discourage corrupt behaviors. The judges had deliberated, the scores are tallied, so now we'll have the head judge, the Honorable Lillian Mizek, come and do the presentation of the best speaker and the winning team.
Okay, good afternoon, and thank you. This has been a very difficult morning, and I wish I didn't have to come here to do this, because it was extremely difficult judging these two teams. I'm sorry that Raymond Gardner had to leave. You think Caicos, you couldn't impress upon Caicos Express to leave them for another 10 minutes? I'm sure they have been late before. But anyway, be that as it may, business is business. Who am I to tell business people how to run their business? But anyway, if I may just speak to offer some general comments and general observations that we made today. I must tell you that this particular topic was, it looked easy. Oh well, we can, you know, we can just knock this off. But opposing that was a very, very difficult task. And I must tell you that having been around for all these long years, when I looked at it and I said, well, how will anybody oppose that? But I was just right into it this morning. I mean, I learned some things this morning. I heard some stuff, and I was kind of taken aback. You know, when you talk about, when they were opposing, for example, opposing this particular moot, it reminded me of something I heard a couple of years ago. And Mr. Otonia, you may recall it, because it was something we debated in the consultative forum when we were looking at the integrity bill. And I remember one of the members getting up and saying, you can't legislate integrity. It is something that has to come from within. And listening to the debaters this morning, you know, impressed upon me the need, and I hope upon the Integrity Commission, the need to get all hands on deck. Because if it is something that you can't legislate and it must come from within, you have to instill it from birth. And so you have to bring everybody on board so that your job as Integrity Commission will be easier, perhaps. But it was interesting, and it was an interesting debate from both sides, proposing and opposing. And I must commend you again for the depth of research that you have done. And I'm sure as an English teacher in the back there, Reverend Julia, you might have been so pleased to hear the metaphor. And you talked about the tree. I see somebody looking strange. You didn't realize that you were using a metaphor when you talked about the trees. Very, very, and you did. Uh-huh. Very, very interesting that you were able to bring it all together. I certainly hope that those persons who, the students who are here, those who are listening in Radio Land, and I'm sure those who haven't heard it today, it will be replayed at some stage, will listen very carefully and offer you even greater encouragement to continue in that particular vein. You have done, both sides, you have done exceptionally well. I'm not too sure I was happy when I heard, you know, someone talking about stealing one of the carts, but the educated person could steal the whole trade. So, I'm not too sure we educated people were happy to hear something like that. But yeah, somebody said it. Somebody. I just wrote down educated thieves. But You have done well, and I want to commend you students for the work that you have done, but I think commendation must also go to your teachers and those and your parents and all others who have assisted you. And I want to encourage you to come back next year as well. Those of you who will be in still in school next year to come back as well. So having said that, the scores, how do you want me to read these scores? From yesterday as well? You want me to go from yesterday and say who's in fourth position, who's in third position? Okay, so when we look at the four teams from yesterday and we tally the scores, in fourth position would be, or is, Wesley Methodist from Providenciales with 401 points. And then in third position is Marjorie Basden High with 420 points. And from today, in second position with 431 points is Clement Howell High School. And with just a difference of 9 points is Raymond Gardner High School with 440 points. And the best speaker for today is speaker number 3 from the opposing team, Raymond Gardner High School. You know, when you come into a competition, somebody wins, they say, and somebody loses. But I don't consider any of you losers. Just somebody get more points than you. And you take it in that vein that, oh well, and it's only 9 points. I suppose when we go through and do the post-mortem exercise, you'll see where perhaps you've fallen down, and I'm sure that will be communicated to you and to your teachers and those who assisted you. But you are, as far as I am concerned, you are all winners. And so, again, I commend you. I wish you all the best. Godspeed, safe travel back to your various islands. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mistress Mizek. Congratulations to all the participants. You all did an exceptional job. But congratulations to, well, the champions of the Integrity Commission's third inter-high school debate competition. That is the Raymond Gardner High School. Congratulations to Ms. Leah B. Medorstein, who was awarded the title of Best Speaker. At this time, we'll call to the podium Ms. McCartney to bring the vote of thanks.
In the words of Cicero, a thankful heart is not only the greatest virtue, but the parent of all other virtues. It is therefore with a thankful heart that I express sincerest thanks to all that has made this, our third inter-high integrity debate, a success. On behalf of the commissioners and staff of the Integrity Commission, I thank you. A big thank you to our chairperson that did an awesome job. Please give her a round of applause. She surely had words for all of us and great pointers for all the speakers. I bow my head in gratitude to all our judges who had a difficult task, but they did an amazing job. May I mention their names? Pastor Roy Lindsay, Honorable Lillian Mizek, Ms. Shatalia Hall, Dr. Eden, Dr. Therese Maitland, and Dr. Benjamin. A special thank you is extended to all persons who are a part of the program. Father Canon Kendall, our commissioner, Mr. Tanye, our director, Reverend Nixon Dickinson, and our representative from the Ministry of Education in the form of our Deputy Secretary, Mr. Cox. And he's not here now, but I want him to know that we at the Integrity Commission, will hold his sentiments of support in setting up and sustaining our Integrity Commission clubs. Thanks to Radio Turks and Caicos for broadcasting this competition live, and for Blueprint Media, who is also video recording this event. Please note that it will be on our website, www.integritycommission.tc. We also say special thanks to all persons that has graced us with your presence, Honorable Derek Taylor, all our schools, Faith Preparatory, and the Eliza Simons Primary School, as well as H.J. Robinson High School, and all others who came to share with us. Please give them a round of applause. We say thanks, and thanks again to the H.J. Robinson High School family for granting us permission to use this, their auditorium, and for allowing the students to witness this informative and stimulating event. Sincerest thanks to all parents, school principals, and teachers for their continued support. This is our third annual Integrity High debate. The Commission depends heavily on your support for the future of this competition and the Integrity Clubs. Thank you for encouraging our bright stars. Thank you for encouraging our bright stars to participate in this, our Inter-High Integrity Debate, and for all your hard work. Hard work certainly pays off. Just contemplate on the performances of our students yesterday and today. Please continue to encourage our students to do the right thing always. And students, please do not be afraid to challenge us, the adults, to do the right thing as well. In thanking our students, let me start off by doing the right thing and asking all our teams that are here now to please stand and to ask us all to give them a rousing applause. Please stand. Thank you. Please also note that prizes will be given during our Anti-Corruption Day activities, which will be held in December. Thank you very much for participating in the competition, and congratulations to a job well done. We express our gratefulness by saying thanks to all who were involved in technical arrangements, decorations, the stage setting, Pastor Altidore and team, our sound system team, Mistress Elizabeth Bean, and Mr. Sees for providing the scrumptious snacks, and all who provided meals for our students. Sunshine Restaurant for providing breakfast, Restaurant Chanel for lunch, and Windjammers for dinner. Madam Chair, honorable judges, ladies and gentlemen, students, no duty is more urgent than that of returning thanks. Therefore, once again, I want to express our sincerest thanks to everyone that has made this our third annual debate a success. And remember to do the right thing always, especially when no one is around. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. McCartney. I think it's only fair that the Integrity Commission deserves a well-deserved round of applause as well. And I am sure this event achieved its purpose of fostering in our youth an understanding of the standards of integrity which will be expected from them as citizens of the TCI. So thank you for that. Today was a great day, don't you agree? But as they say, sadly, all great things must eventually come to an end. Once again, thank you all for joining us for the Integrity Commission's third inter-high school debate competition. Remember, stand for what is right every time and everywhere. Goodbye and enjoy the rest of your day.